Welcome to V8 Nation, talking all things motorsport with Rick Kelly and Paul Dumbrell.
Hello everybody, a very warm welcome to V8 Nation, Rick Kelly and Paul Dumbrell in the studio for the next hour to talk all things motorsport, and plenty going on as we are getting into the last round of the V8 season championship weekend. We're going to talk all about that. We're going to talk about Mark Webber and his Formula One, GrandForSpeedCafe.com to join us, and a very special guest will be joining us later in the hour too to talk a little bit about PD and his farewell. So join, the boys join in.
I protest already.
Oh, already?
I don't know who this guest is and I feel like I've been stitched up.
No, you haven't been stitched up. The person will join us shortly and I'll give you a hint, she is not a former flame. We couldn't find one of them, but she, you will know her. You've met her before. That's all I'll say.
I don't believe that comment. That's not too hard.
Now,
I've got a question.
Already?
I've never seen
already.
This before. We always comment on what. Why is PD wearing denim shorts with
skins underneath?
Skins underneath.
I'm not sure. He's gone the Jerry Seinfeld. Remember how Jerry used to wear the jeans with the runners? He's gone the jean shorts with the ASICs with skins underneath. And one of those compression shirts on top while eating a pizza. So obviously you've been in some good form, PD.
Yeah, hey, just try to keep my training up for the last weekend of the year. It's quite nerve wracking actually. Just lining up for the final race of my full time career. So I thought I'd go for a bit of a run and let off some energy tonight. Obviously, Rico, as you're well aware, you didn't meet me for pizza, so a little bit disappointed, to be honest, to not be.
Well, what normally happens is I make a call and just confirm whether you're going to want pizza or not, and that's sort of how I judge whether I'll get it.
My text message to you at about 5 o'clock today or 5:30 today saying, "Hey, mate,
it was seven.
Mate, that's when you turn your phone on after being flat.
Hey, just before we get into it, boys, don't forget Spitwater high pressure cleaners. They've been built here in Australia for nearly 30 years, and they're still going strong, just like you two gentlemen. When you need a serious cleaner with real muscle, Spitwater, that's what it does. Make sure spitwater.com.au, you do check it out. Now, before we talk all about the V8s and the incredible pressure on Wincup and Lowndes and all the boys, or the two boys who can win it, let's talk about Mark Webber. We're going to talk about his challenge a little bit later on in the show. Obviously, Grant will speak about it as well. But last week, after having a disappointing season, I reckon, by his own standards, he thought he could challenge for the championship, gets a win in Brazil by 16 seconds and he wins his 7th Grand Prix.
Well, you're only as good as your last race, aren't you? And I mean, he's got... No? Is that a bad comment?
That comment works well for the person who's won the last race. That's about it.
You never hear Sebastian Vettel say that. He's the champion, but
he didn't really pass for Vettel and run away with it. Obviously, Vettel had gearbox problems, which took him out of the lead at that point of the race. But, Mark was heading into the last round wondering if, or probably thinking he would get through the whole year without a win. And obviously, Sebastian did an awesome job to take it out and take out most of the races. So I reckon he'd be over the moon with that result. And you get to have the whole off season now thinking about that, and finishing on a high is pretty important, because it's a little bit like V8 supercars. Generally, the team that has great results in the last three or four rounds of one championship starts the next championship very strong. So well done to him. I mean, like I say, that's a great way to end.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, it's quite funny. You look at Vettel, like, just dominated the year. Most pole, or equal to the most poles ever in a season. Phenomenal amount of wins. And literally, he had to bring the car home, actually being in the wrong gear for the whole of the last stint after he got passed by Mark. So he did a phenomenal job to even finish. And I think Red Bull have actually come out and said the car shouldn't have finished. Like, the damage it had done, and there was all conspiracy theories out there saying that they let Mark go through so that he could wrap up third in the championship. But from all reports, that it was actually a genuine problem, and Vettel just managed it like he's done everything else this year, just managed it with flying colours and got through. And speaking about Mark, and obviously it's great for him to have a win and 7th win in F1, would he be sitting down ruing and the team be thinking about all of his starts this year? Because every start that I've watched on TV, he's absolutely stuffed.
And in F1.
In F1, there's so many driver aids and team aids, and Vettel just consistently could outpace him on the start line. And even if Vettel could do a better job with him, Mark, and not directly this at Mark, obviously the team or the car or whatever it might have been, he used to go back from first or second on the grid to like 5th or 6th, and that was the best case. He's been even further back. So it makes it so challenging when you do all the hard work, you've got the best car in the field, qualifying 1-2, and then not actually, starting the race fundamentally in 4th or 5th spot. You got so much work to even get back there. And when you're chasing Vettel, you need everything going for you to be able to actually, compete with him.
I'm not sure, boys, if this is a question you can answer, but why does he struggle at the start? Is it the car? Is it him? Because he hasn't had trouble starting previously. He was starting all right in 2010 when he had a wonderful year.
I'm not exactly sure, but I'm pretty sure PD will know a little bit more about it.
Yep, PD.
Yeah, well, absolutely. I from what Rico was telling me with his close Red Bull links, and obviously we know how much Red Bull helps Rico and gets, like, you know, Casey Stoner, for example, down to the garage at Bathurst to have a chat to Rick.
I think Mark Webber, I think Rico's actually put together a guest for tonight. I think it's Mark Webber, is it?
No,
it's not. Of course it's not.
Will you actually even be able to speak to him next week?
Oh, I'll be sort of 10 deep in the crowd that are gathered around him.
Will you speak to his people and his people will tell your people?
I don't even think I'll get to speak to his people.
Do you think Rick might hear the old, "I'm pretty comfortable here, thank you," like he did at Bathurst with another champion in Casey Stoner?
Yes.
Hey, let's talk about the last round. Homebush this weekend, V8. You know, a wonderful season's coming to a close. Career's coming to a close, PD, which we will touch on a little bit later on. I just want to talk. Have you been emotional leading in as Rick Kelly leaves the studio? I'm assuming it's a toilet run.
I reckon I'm getting set up here. Like, you're giggling. It's very, very dangerous.
No, it's not. Let's talk about, have you felt the week leading in knowing this is your last race of your full-time driving career?
Hey, it's actually pretty sad, to be honest. I probably have underplayed how much I've been thinking about it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I get to this weekend, I'm really just thinking about what it's going to be on Sunday afternoon after the checkered flag, driving back into the pits, knowing that's the last time I'm ever going to drive for a full-time basis. And, Rico, look at that.
Yeah. Well, what we've done for people who are obviously aren't in the radio studio, and you can check out V8 Nation on YouTube, we put together what we thought PD's career was worth, and we came up with a scoop of ice cream.
Well, we've spent, I don't know, Cam, what is it, 3-4 weeks going around the office and getting everyone's ideas and really putting into this big for PD's career. And so we come up with a little bit of ice cream and a congrats message on a plate.
Yeah,
so
did you spell that, or is that spelled right?
Congrats.
No, I think that actually says PO rather than PD. And we actually
mate, thank you very much, guys. That actually means a lot. Actually, I appreciate our last 34 weeks has actually come down to a free ice cream.
And mind you, if you do return to full-time driving, which we believe you probably will, we want that $6 back that he's paid on a farewell scoop of ice cream. So
thanks, mate.
Just remember that while you're tucking into it and next time you think about changing around.
Exactly. But on a serious note, mate, congratulations. I mean, big weekend this weekend. So obviously keen to go down there and get a good result. But from everyone at Croc Media and V8 Nation, well done. And so how you know we got that? We actually went down to Fred Leno's for dinner just before, and that's what we come back with. And so you got pizzas, but we got you the dessert, which we put weeks of thought into.
And that's why we couldn't actually invite you to dinner as well, because it would have ruined the surprise.
Yeah.
To be honest, from last time I checked, you weren't invited to dinner either. Yeah. Rico made sure you had a table for two, and
that's a very good,
one of the two.
That's a very good point, actually. That's why Rico won't be getting my $3 for this scoop of ice cream. But no, congratulations, seriously. And echo Rick's thoughts. It's been great this year on V8 Nation, and look forward to having you next year. And I'm assuming you're a bit more
armchair
honest.
Armchair expert.
You can actually start to say what you think now.
Imagine me saying exactly what I think about everyone. It's going to be quite phenomenal.
I think you've done a good job of that in the last few weeks anyway.
Have you and Frosty started talking yet?
Who?
You and your teammate Frosty?
Oh, no.
Now, I ducked out of the studio. Did you touch on how excited you are about the weekend when I was out?
Mate, we pretty much covered all that.
Okay.
It's going to be an emotional time. I actually don't think it's going to really hit me until the first round next year. The year, if I was continuing or not, this was the end of the year, so, you know, it is what it is. Well, I think over the summer, you know, generally you sort of try and think about motor racing as least as possible. That's what I do most of the time anyway. and you get to the first race or the first test next year, and I won't be the main driver. I might be there driving another car, or my car, maybe. I don't know which one it might be. But
say again, what are you going to be doing?
A second.
The first test day, like the opening day. Don't the endurance drivers come along and get a steer?
No, mate.
I don't even do that. Okay. I might go there and, like, you know, just, like, you know, buff the car, polish the car.
Have you signed a contract yet anywhere for 2012?
That's a very direct question, mate.
Well, everybody wants to know what you're up to next year. Do you know yet or not?
I'm well advanced.
I'm well advanced. All right. Well, look forward to you driving Kelly Racing as well next year. Let's change the topic a little bit, because coming into the last round is a very exciting
That's PD
time.
Eating his special surprise ice cream.
It's a very exciting time, no doubt. But I just want to get... obviously, Wynn Cup and Lowndes are the only two gentlemen coming into this weekend that can win it and could have won it. You've been in a situation leading into it, first time, up against Craig Lowndes as well. What's the pressure feeling as you head into it, knowing that if you drive well on the weekend, you could be the V8 Supercar champion, or if you stuffed something up, you could finish second, third, or beyond?
Yeah, it's a very good question because so much of your life revolves around your racing, or your whole life does. So when you head into the last round with the opportunity to win, particularly when you haven't done it before, it's a very, very daunting thing. And this weekend's very interesting. I mean, the thing that does dull it down a little bit is Jamie has got, I think it was, is it 187 points, PD? Or around
188
lead. So it's going to be very tough for Craig, but it is very, very pressured environment, and it's very stressful. There's no doubt about it, because each lap, each corner from qualifying to the race counts for something that you've dreamt about your whole life, and it all comes down to one race. So it's going to be interesting from the point of view that Craig Lowndes is very experienced at coming into the last round trying to fight for the championship. He's won championships before and fought for them before, and this is Jamie Wincup's third go as well. So and they're both from the same team, so it would be very interesting to see them come in a little bit closer on points and see what happened. It would be a great race to watch.
But Rico, Wincup, well, Jamie actually, you know, went into the last round last year in contention. He was probably in Craig's position last year when Courtney fundamentally only had to finish as well. So he knows how gut-wrenching it is to be on the other end of that. So I reckon he's come away and had huge determination this year to actually deliver. And how dominant he's actually been. He's had probably a bit of bad luck as well. A few DNFs not related to him as well, Bathurst as well. So, I reckon, you know, he probably could have even wrapped up the championship prior to the actual last round.
Yeah, it was
the last couple of rounds are bad luck.
Did you find yourself, Rico, doing anything differently leading into it? Like, did you think you drove differently at all over the course of the weekend? It was in Phillip Island, wasn't it?
It was at Phillip Island. I actually had a out of the blue phone call from Andy Prio, who's the world supercar champion, world touring car champion, I should say. And he was giving me advice on the other end of the phone, and everyone was full of advice. And there's nothing you can do different at that point. You just want to do the very best job that you've ever done in a race car. And it's difficult. I mean, when I did it at Phillip Island, there was the incident with Craig in the last race. But leading into that, we had pit stop failures in one race. We had the dash failure, so we didn't have anything in, shift lights or any of that sort of thing. So it's amazing. You want everything to go right on that weekend. And being a race car and everything stressed to the max, always little things go wrong. So
your teammates blocking Craig Lowndes, and who got a drive-through penalty for that as well?
No, did it?
Yeah, Garth.
No, he didn't get a drive-through penalty. No.
Bad sportsmanship flag?
No, that was all sportsman-like.
Who for you?
Yeah. But that's the thing. I mean, both these guys...
There's a lot to talk about that. We probably got to talk about, like, you drove for the Walkinshaw Racing Holladilla team, which was actually owned... Well, you own that team, but I guess all four cars are under the Walkinshaw umbrella.
Yeah, and they did work together to do the best for that. There's no doubt about it. And we've seen that from Triple Eight before, and any other team. Like, if you've got a team there, you'll use it. And Triple Eight do that. You've seen when one car's faster or whatever their strategy is, you just plain and simple get out of the way for the other one to go through. And it's a very interesting scenario this weekend, because they're going in there, they've only got two cars, and both their cars are fighting for that championship. So if Jamie has obviously a terrible race Saturday and Craig does very well, it will make for a very, very interesting Sunday.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. So anyway, that's Sydney was on Saturday last year. It was the conditions of all conditions, really, wasn't it? It had rain, everyone was on slick tyres. I think we had all three championship contenders all crash out.
Yeah,
I remember I came around, I was down the back, it's like pretty much like usual towards the end of last year.
I was actually behind you, though. You? Yeah, okay. I was a few cars back.
Right, cool. Good. I actually came down to this corner, I think it's turn 7, whatever it is, and it was literally, you could not see with the amount of rain. Everyone was on slick tyres. I was down to first gear. I came around this left-hander, and there was, I think, 7 or 8 cars in the fence. And I'm turning around, I go, here, it's obviously a fairly big crash. And there was 3 cars reversing down the track.
Yeah, 100%.
And I was like, what's wrong with this picture? Like, it was phenomenal. And I was doing 20 k's an hour or 30 k's an hour. And I was nearly in the fence as well. It was just some of the most bizarre conditions I've seen. But, I guess what won James Courtney the championship then was the team's determination to actually get the car out.
Getting back.
Fixed. Yeah, and they got out and actually just circulated and got a few points.
Exactly.
Jono Webb won the last race of the year, didn't he?
Yep. I think he actually won it from the most furthest spot back. I think he started 22nd or 25th. I think it's the furthest someone's won a race from the starting position.
And the first 8 or 10 cars smashed out, and then obviously it was wet from then on. He had wets, and he drove,
He was under a lot of pressure from Bridie there towards the end of the race, so he did a very good job.
Did a good job in the wet.
At V8 Nation, if you'd like to get involved on Twitter, you can email us, v8nation@crocmedia.com.
This is V8 Nation with Rick Kelly and Paul Dumbrell.